This is a production of WKNO Memphis. Production funding for Sports Files is made possible in part by the WKNO Production Fund, the WKNO Endowment Fund, and by viewers like you. Thank you.
Tonight on the show, we'll have a return appearance by Memphis football coach Justin Fuente. Okay, so I don't know if this was a coincidence or anything, but I went to the Memphis football spring game Saturday and the sun was shining. People were out having fun. This blue-gray game was way more blue skies than gray clouds. And the offense did this incredibly amazing thing in which the quarterback drops back and, see if you can follow me here, throws the ball to a receiver who then catches it and runs. Ah, yes, progress comes to Memphis football. It was remarkable and fun to see. And absolutely, I know that Justin Fuente hasn't coached a single real game or even a single real snap. Spring football isn't an accurate measure of anything. But it's impossible to miss the difference in spirit around the Memphis football program, the difference in fundamental competence, honestly. I don't have any idea if Fuente can transform what has been a long, woebegone program, but I know he has a chance. I know he has vision, and I know he has energy. And I know that around here, that's a pretty big change. We had Fuente on the show right after he got the Memphis coaching job. Back then, he really didn't have the lay of the land. So what does he think now that he's been here a few months? We'll find out coming up next. As promised, rejoined now for the second time by Justin Fuente, coach of the Memphis Tigers, and you now have done some coaching as head coach. How's it been?
It's been good. I've had a lot of fun out there. You know, we've got a really good staff of guys that enjoy teaching, and there's plenty of teaching to be done, and by and large, a large portion of the group of kids has bought into what we're trying to do, and I've really enjoyed myself.
So, okay, so let's there's some big things I want. I don't think I've had you on since recruiting, since your staff, since the Big East, so we'll get to all that in a minute, just in terms of what you've been doing and the football team. You take over this group. It's down in number. And sort of what has been the goal through spring practice?
The biggest thing is the health of our team. You know, can we build the foundation of what makes a good team? Accountability, dependability, responsibility. Can we install those core values to our guys and make them individually accountable? You know, I think we have some large strides to make from a physical standpoint. We've got to get stronger and bigger just as a team. But the biggest thing we've talked about are kind of the four pillars of our program, which are academic integrity, social responsibility, individual accountability, and competitive excellence. But mostly we've focused on individual accountability. You know, I think one of the biggest holes that's been on this team, best I can tell from the past, is we've had individuals that were just that, individuals, and not accountable to the whole group. So, you know, the health and well-being of our team has been our primary focus. Can we get the kids all together to go work together and be there every day and be consistent and be disciplined in order to have just a healthy team and working environment to start with?
And you mentioned sometimes when a new coach takes over, there's malcontents, right, rolling their eyes. A third of the team might not. Here, it's been largely, people have been, the players have been largely receptive.
By and large, now there's a few that we've had to drag kicking and screaming, and that's just the way it is. They're either going to jump on board,
right,
or get out. But the most of our kids, even the seniors that have been through a lot, you know, Jordan Debbie comes to mind, offensive lineman, has just jumped in with both feet and gone to work. So for most of them, like anything else, and probably in any business, you spend most of your time dealing with a few of the squeaky wheels. But But by and large, a large number of our kids have really done exactly what we've asked them.
Has the job, okay, so that's sort of, I gather, one of the refreshing things is the how many people have jumped on board. Mm-hmm. Is the job bigger in some ways than you thought?
Well, I think I had a pretty good idea what I was getting into. You know, I had a little bit of knowledge about the team. They've been a pleasant surprise from a willing and wanting to be a part of something standpoint. I feel like I'm as prepared as anybody for this job, but there's still things that you don't think of. You know, I mean, I made lists upon lists of the way I wanted to handle situations and what I wanted to do with certain people in certain roles and all that sort of stuff. And as prepared as you are, you still get in the middle of it and go, man, I didn't even think of that. You know, how are we going to address that, or how do we want to handle that? So, you know, there's a few things, but that one of the reasons that we were able to hire, or a couple of the guys that we brought on the staff, are there for that role. You know, Daryl Dickey is a guy that's been a head coach, a Division I head coach for 9 years. And, you know, he's there to help me in some of those things that I just didn't think of.
Let me ask you about the staff real quick, because you brought it up. Did you know Daryl Dickey? Daryl Dickey obviously was a head coach for a long time, and a successful head coach in North Texas. You're from Texas. What was your relationship with him, and what was the idea of getting him?
Yeah, I knew him, and, you know, coaches are just like knitting circles. I mean, we all talk, and we all know each other, and you know, and if you don't know him directly, usually know several guys that do. But I knew Daryl, and I knew a couple guys, or was really close to a couple guys that had worked with Daryl.
Right.
So we had never worked together, but I knew Coach Dickey.
Was he
before.
The guy who you like when you sit down for your interview? I have this vision that you say, "Here are the people I'm going to be
sure.
on my staff." Was he written down on the piece of paper?
Absolutely.
He's going to be my offensive coordinator.
Uh huh. Yep.
He was.
Mm-hmm. And fortunately enough, a large portion of the staff that we have was on that list. We were able to get the guys that we really, really wanted.
What's his role going to be in the offense in New York? Because obviously that's your bread
sure.
and butter too.
No, and Coach Dickey and I have had several good conversations about that. First of all, when I'm off doing head coaching duties, I don't want the offensive staff to stop. I don't want
right.
the wheels to stop. So. He's going to continue to handle the staff when I'm not around. Obviously, when I'm in there, it's a little different dynamic. But he's somebody that I envision when we get into the season leaning on heavily, you know, for a game plan and that sort of stuff. And he still addresses the offense before we go scrimmage. He'll come bring him up and talk to him and that kind of stuff. So, you know, he is the offensive coordinator. He just has the head coach.
But you will be the play caller.
Yeah, I will. I'll call the
plays. Will it be different for you? Were you in the press box?
I was. It will be different. And it takes a little getting used to, you know, to be on the field. And Coach Dickey's been a head coach that's called plays. And we've talked a little bit about the difference between sitting up there in kind of a nice, clean environment, looking through a window, watching the game and calling the game, as opposed to standing down there.
He will be up there, but
he'll be
your
upstairs.
Eyes up there. He'll have that, yes. and he'll be mm-hmm. able to feed that to
yep.
you.
Yep.
And then on the defensive side, Barry Odom, from what was your relationship with him?
Well, I've known Coach Odom for a long time, and he's a guy that I had a lot of respect for when he came through as a football player at Missouri. Really the kind of a hard hat, under-talented, overachiever type guy, and has really worked his way up through the ranks at the University of Missouri. The best assistant coach on that staff, and he and I have been in touch for years now, and I never thought that he would leave Missouri. He played there. He'd lived there for a long,
right.
long time, and, you know, guys always talk about hypothetical situations,
right.
but when this situation came open, I got a hold of him. And
so why'd you do it?
I don't know. You'd have to ask him why. I think he really wanted to be a coordinator, and I think he really wanted to build this thing. And he is not a guy that steps into things lightly. I mean, he had a whole, you know, he sits down, and we go through the interview, and he says, "Coach, I have a couple questions for you," and it's a whole legal pad full of, I mean, he is
right.
a very thorough person,
right.
so he doesn't jump into anything lightly.
Has the staff been good? Has it worked?
Oh,
has it come? I mean, because there is that, you mentioned the personality of a team. There is a personality of a staff, too.
We have a great staff. We have a very close-knit staff. Many of the guys have worked together before. Somewhere along the way, you know, I have more than just coaching relationships with almost all of them. I either played with them, either lived with them as a young coach. One was in my wedding. One I played for. He was the offensive line coach when I was a player. So we just have, you know, there's a lot of intertwining of stories that have kind of come together here at Memphis. So they've been really, really good.
Part of the challenge here has been, honestly, keeping staff. And mm-hmm. and you'll always want people to progress sure. and do well. You don't want it to be
a revolving door.
Mm-hmm. How do you feel? Do you feel like there's the commitment here to keep them? And do you feel like there's a spirit of we're in this to get this job done?
Absolutely. I think all of our guys signed on knowing full well what the situation was. I didn't recruit any of them. I informed them. I sat them down and said, listen, here's the deal. You know, I know most of y'all's wives personally. I don't want them mad at me.
Right.
You know, I want you all to know exactly what's going on. Here's where we're at. Here's my best guess of where we're at as a team. Here's where we're at facility-wise, so on and so forth. And just kind of laid it out there for them. So I think they all understand, you know, where we're at. Those guys are going to have opportunities. They're too good not to.
Right.
And I'm hopeful that's because we've done a good job here getting this thing turned around. And when we do that, I'm hopeful that we'll reward them and step up for them and keep them around.
Okay, back to what you've learned this spring. Obviously, people want to hear about quarterbacks.
Mm-hmm.
What's the quarterback situation?
Well, I feel really good about our quarterback situation. I don't lose any sleep at night about that spot. You know, Jacob Karam has come in and really jumped in and immersed himself in the offense, and while has made some mistakes and that sort of stuff, has played well at times. Taylor Reed, the guy that the young man that played last year, has really come in. And, you know, it's a little bit hard for him just because it's only his second semester of college, and it's his second offense. So it takes a little bit more just with him just because he's a little bit younger. But I've been really impressed with his athletic ability, his ability to absorb the offense and understand and compute what's going on. So both of those guys, I think, have made strides in the spring. They're not exactly where I want them, but I can foresee them both playing well for us.
And then you have a new quarterback coming in from a freshman from Florida. You're just going to let it go into the fall and pick who's best?
Yeah, that's what we'll do. We'll continue to let those guys, you know, compete through the summertime and then go into the fall. I don't think that that's a major issue right now for our team. I don't feel any need to rush to judgment on that. I think both of our kids have done a really good job of demonstrating leadership and working hard. They're both the right kind of people that you want to play that position. So, you know, we're just going to sit on it, let those guys continue to compete and go work about it and then just continue to try and address the other stuff.
Okay, so you don't lose sleep over that. What do you lose sleep about?
Well, you know, we're pretty paper thin at some spots. You know, offensive line, we have a handful of guys that I think can go out there and play, but we've got to really do a good job developing some of the other ones. You know, we have some accountability issues at a couple other places that, you know, if we get fixed, I think the kids that are there have a chance to help us. If we don't get it fixed, then we'll move on. But, you know,
when you say that, is Kewan Malone one of the accountability
issues? Well, yeah, we have a couple
issues,
spots.
Right? You've had...
Yeah, you know, and I really, really like Kewan. Not to just get too into Kewan's
right.
business, but I really, really want him to do well. I really do. I like him. He's got a great personality. He's funny when he's on the football field. By and large, he's a good worker. But he's got to understand that, and all our kids have to understand that if I'm given the choice between picking you and the team, I'm going to do what's right for the team every single time. I've got to protect the guys that do things the right way. And so I'm going to always choose the side of the team. So we've got some issues there that we've got to, you know, I want to get them worked out. I'm not going to just sit back. I'm going to do everything I
right.
can to make sure we get them worked out. But ultimately, some of those guys, not just Kewan, have to step up and do it themselves.
What people are going to want, are you going to win games? I look out there and it is, I think everyone has been impressed by the energy, enthusiasm, staff, and all that. I think everyone is struck by how little, I don't know, the cupboard's bare, but it's not exactly fully stocked. You do have a schedule that's amenable to winning some games. How important will it be to, and we'll talk about this more in the fall, but to show some signs of progress that involve actual W's?
Well, I don't know. You know, obviously I want to. I think we have a chance to. There's some variables there. First of all, it's the summertime. We have to make progress. I mean, right. These are the guys we have. Let's go coach them up and get them as good as we can.
Right.
And, you know, that's our job. It is teaching and coaching. So I'm not going to make excuses for anything. You know, I think we have a chance, you know, and that's if we put the work in. And if we don't put the work in and we don't do the right thing, then we don't have a chance. So, you know, I don't know if I'm answering your question right. or not, but if we do the right things along the way, I think we'll have a chance. Now, will there be some things involved that may be beyond our control? Do we have to stay healthy? Yes.
Right.
Do we have to be able to handle adversity? Yes. I think that's one of the biggest things that these kids have got to understand is it's easy to be on board right now.
Right.
Okay. But what about if we stumble? Now, right. who's going to be on board and who's not going to be on board? And, you know, the whole front runner mentality. And we've got to have it deep in our heart that we're bought in and sold out to getting this thing done, regardless of the circumstances.
In terms of the things that you, having been here and seeing the lay of the land a little bit, the things that you need to get done for this to be the program you want to be, whether it's recruiting, whether it's facilities, whether it's community support, whether it's, have you sort of thought about these are the fundamental areas where we have to get better?
Sure. Well, we have to continue to improve our facilities. You know, we're going to take another step up in a year in competition. And while I think we're okay right now or with our current progress in, you know, comparing it to other Conference USA schools, we're stepping up to the big leagues. And we have to continue to make a push and make the most of this transition. You know, this transition to the Big East is more than just saying we're in the Big East. It's going to require a larger commitment from everybody, from our program, from the athletic department, from the university, from the community. The other thing is we have got to give the people in the city something to hang their hat on when it comes to Memphis football. And, you know, it's going to start with baby steps. It's going to start with them looking out there and realizing there's a bunch of guys doing it the right way, working hard, being accountable, and, you know, being well-coached, well-organized, and well-prepared. And then hopefully, you know, that'll continue to build support. And, you know, I'm going to do my part by getting out here in the next.
You know, you said you're going to wrap up with practice.
Yeah.
Tomorrow is your last day of practice. And then you're going to talk to everyone.
Basically, I have about a week where we kind of take stock of spring ball, and then the assistant coaches hit the road recruiting. I'm not allowed to go on the road in the spring, and that's when I'm going to go. The coaches go recruit players, I go recruit fans. And, you know, I'll be out in the community. I have not every day is taken up, but almost all of them with some luncheon or some place to go speak and kind of spread the word.
Is it been tricky at all with the, you don't have an AD right now. Have you been looped into this? Who do you want, Justin? I mean, what's
well,
what's that? And who do you go to if there's an issue?
Well, RC is still the athletic director. So, you know, we still meet and talk. But I would be less than honest if I didn't say it is a little bit of an interesting situation. You know, I'm not sure what direction they're going to go. I know they're going to have very competent people together to go and make that decision. You know, and, you know, I think, I don't want to say I'm looking forward to it. I just think that the transition period, I think, you know, once we kind of get through it, because it is a little bit of a, you know, I mean, it's just an odd situation right now. And once they get to, you know, once, whatever that date is, June 1st for RC comes, and then the new guy comes in, guy or girl, I guess I should say, comes in, then maybe it'll be just a little bit more of a normal relationship. Right.
Well, do you ever worry about the time? The timing is interesting for you because there's always a honeymoon. I mean, you're going to, people are, expect the team to be better next year. They want to see improvement. Year three or so, people want W's to be lots of them. And that's basically when you're going to be going into the Big East, too. You'll be stepping up competition. How do you manage this? And are you recruiting to the Big East now?
Absolutely we are. You know, we're recruiting to the Big East because, you know, it's one more year in Conference USA and then we're in it. So, absolutely we are. It's a step up in competition. And, yeah, that is, you know, I'm not going to tell you that, that's no big deal. It is a big deal. You know, we're going to go play better teams week in and week out. And I'm not trying to denigrate Conference USA. Right. It's just, you know, those programs have, there's really good football teams in Conference USA, but, you know, just on a week in, week out basis, it's just going to be a bigger physical opponent. So absolutely, it's something we have to address and we don't have time to waste. You know, we want to, that's why I think our work in the weight room is the most important thing from a physical standpoint that we can get done right now.
Okay, so how's your wife and kids adjusting? How's the community? How's it been?
They're doing really well. You know, we have a house.
Part of town?
We are just a couple miles from campus. We're just, you know, kind of tried to stay in the community because I wanted it to be accessible for the girls to come over. I wanted to be able to have our kids over to the house to eat or be around if they needed anything. But they're doing well. They're enjoying it. You know, the girls are so young that they don't care.
It's not missing the fun.
And Jenny's really enjoying
it. She's pulling a lot of weight, I take it.
Yeah, she's, you know, got the baby and all that kind of stuff. But she's excited to, you know, we have a group of women on staff that, you know, by and large, she knows a good portion of them already going into it. So she's excited about that. But We've enjoyed our short time here.
Okay, so if people can, and we got to wrap up here in just a second. If people can watching this can do anything for the program, what can they do? What can people who want Memphis football to be successful do?
Well, I think the biggest thing is I think that you can spread the word. You know, we're going to build a program that this community can be proud of. You know, how long is it going to take, or what is it? How do you define what it is that you're proud of? I'm not sure. It's up to you, but. But we're going to do this thing the right way. We're going to be involved in the community, and we're going to go build a program this city can be proud of. You know, the second thing is come out. You know, come out to the games. You know, there's just different. It's just different when there's people there. And, you know, that's why I'm okay with practice being open, because I think our kids play better when there's people there watching.
Right.
And, you know, not to say that you win games if the stands are full, but it's just different. And, you know, I think coming out and – you know, wearing your blue and gray and spreading the word are the best ways to get this thing going.
Someone I heard came out wrote a check for some. Was there new equipment or something? What's happening over there?
Yeah, you know, we've got people stepping up for the program right now, and for that we're very grateful. You know, we have some cardio equipment
that we need
in the brand new beautiful weight room that we have. That we've had some people step up and give some money, and for that we're very, very appreciative. And you know, we've got the indoor complex, or indoor facility that we're still raising money for. That's going well.
All right. Thank you very much.
I appreciate it.
Good luck with everything. Good to have you on board.
Thank you.
I'll be back in a moment after one question.
My mom says piano player. I'm trying to become, Coach Fuente wants me to become a better quarterback. So,
which have you been playing longer?
Piano.
Piano long.
Yeah, I've been
piano
since kindergarten.
Since kindergarten.
Yes, sir. So.
And how's the adjustment been here to Memphis and to spring practice?
It's been great. I mean, you know, thankfully I got a great group of guys around me, great coaches, and the adjustment's been pretty easy thanks to them.
Do you feel like, I mean, what's he said to, told you about the competition here? It's open. It's between. How do you feel? About
yeah, he's pretty much guaranteed us both a fair chance, and I'm very appreciative of that. So we've both got a ways to go, and we push each other really hard. Taylor did a tremendous job today. He's done a good job this whole spring, and you know we're going to continue to push each other.
I'll be honest. I was trying my best not to watch basketball last night. I was in my office working my way through a stack of old newspapers. And then I heard my son cheering. He was watching the game in the other room. I thought, could Kansas actually be making a run? So I walked in to join him in the TV room, and there he was watching the Grizzlies game. "I care about this way more than a national championship," he said, out of the mouths of babes, or middle schoolers, as the case may be. On a night that could have been difficult for some Memphians, the Grizzlies stormed to the rescue. They beat Oklahoma City in Oklahoma City. They did it without Mike Conley and Dante Cunningham, who were injured and out. It's as if the basketball gods were telling us to stop thinking about what this community doesn't have and start celebrating what it does. It has Tony Allen and O.J. Mayo. It has Rudy Gay and Marc Gasol. It has Conley and Maurice Spates and Zebo and Hamed Haddadi. It has Chris Wallace as its blue-collar general manager and Lionel Hollins as its blue-collar coach. Oh, and it has a playoff race that this team is smack in the middle of, a furious sprint to the finish line. The Grizzlies are now fifth in the Western Conference. If the playoffs started today, they'd meet the Los Angeles Clippers in the first round. But they're only a half game ahead of Dallas and only three games ahead of Utah, which is in ninth. So every single game counts. Speaking of which, the next one starts in, about 10 minutes. The Grizzlies play the Golden State Warriors at FedEx Forum tonight. If you're downtown, you can probably still make it for the tip. But if not this game, try making it to another. After what the Grizzlies did for the community last night, they deserve your support. And that's it for Sports Files this week. Remember, you can always write the show at sportsfiles@wkno.org. To watch the show online, go to wkno.org and click on KNO Tonight. Until next week, yes, I still believe.